I imagine most of you recognized Beethoven's famous Moonlight Sonata, opus 27, number 12. I played it to encourage you to learn how to apply reduction practice to learn easy to very complex pieces like Beethoven's Moonlight Sonata. You'll be able to apply these reduction techniques to learn similar chordal type of pieces. We'll start with an easy piece, that way one day you can play the Moonlight Sonata. Reduction practice means taking complex ideas and reducing or simplifying them down to their basic patterns. Let your brain take multiple ideas and reduce it more into simple thoughts. That way you can process more information together. We've talked about reduction technique within our simple Turk march in G major, which is a simple melody over accompaniment. Remember we isolated where the both hands align. We just thought about the interval of movement. We can also apply reduction techniques to Beethoven's Moonlight Sonata as it's full of arpeggiated chords. Rather than arpeggiating them, which is the idea in turn, I'm going to block them together as one chord. So let's listen to that intro with reduction technique. Right hand's the same chord, only left hand moves. How that feels. My ears are checking the quality as well. So we'll use that technique, and then there's one last step we'll use with reduction technique is to just play where the chords are changing. One more time in the intro, C sharp minor. I'm going to play it with the bass here, major 2, new chord, major 3, A major, beat 3, D over A, which is the Neapolitan chord, G sharp 7, C sharp minor. Just isolating where I have unique chords. So let's start back with an easy piece. So we're going to look at Ferdinand Beyer's Study in C major, opus 101, number 66. Let's use our musical learning pyramid to get us started. The bottom layer is our rhythm. So I always look at my time signature first. I see a new time signature of 6/8. Previously, we've played pieces in 4/4 where the quarter note gets one beat. When an 8 is on the bottom, it means the eighth note now gets one beat. The number on the top tells me there's 6 of those eighth notes. So I'm going to play this first line, and I'd encourage you to tap along with both hands and count. So the counting will be a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Ready to count. 1, ready, go. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Once you've tapped that rhythm, it's basically the same all the way through the piece. As I look through, I notice I have very repetitive patterns in terms of the dotted quarter note, which will get 3 beats. I have eighth notes, which will again get 1 beat. Dotted half note will get the full measure of 6 beats. After that, let's look at our next layer on the pyramid, which is note reading. Look at your key signature. 0 sharps are flat, so I'm in C major. So why don't you warm up on a C major scale with me? Ready, go. Block that major triad. Okay, let's look at some of our landmark notes. The left hand starts on bass C. Looks like the highest I get to in the left hand is an A above our G. So not much of a hand span. The right hand starts on landmark G. Goes up a sixth to start, and that will be my highest pitch. So I only just have spans of fifths and sixths. So let's get to the reduction technique. If I see an arpeggiated chord like this, I go right to my left hand and I practice it. The 3 notes block together, reduce it to 1 chord. I'm just going to block through my groups of 3, major 2, and I notice I have a C major chord, so all stacked in thirds, root position. Measure three. Measure four. The top two notes go up by steps to F and A. Let's pause here for a moment and talk about how to analyze these chords. So this is not root position as it has a fourth in it. You can arpeggiate this chord, roll it up like our inversion practice has us do, until I find root position where it's all stacked in thirds. Once it's in thirds, you can name the chord by its lowest tone, which is F. If you need to, you can count your whole and half steps. I have a four and a three triad, so it's a major chord. Let's play it in the way Beyer shows us in the score. So this would be an F slash C chord. It's a second inversion. So for the classical notation, F is the fourth scale degree in the key of C, 1, 2, 3, 4. So you see an uppercase Roman numeral 4 to show the major quality, and the 6-4 to show second inversion. I have other videos that explain the inversions and these numbers that you can review as well. Let's proceed on measure 5. I stay in that 4, 6, 4. Measure 6 is the same. Measure 7 is the same until the second chord shifts to C, F, G, back to C. Alright, let's go back to that measure 7 second chord. I have a C, F, G. I'm going to analyze that C as like a tonic pedal and just continues on from the previous C chord. I have F and G, and the right hand provides a B. Often you have to look at your melody to get a complete analysis. I bring it down into my left hand, definitely not in root position since I have a second. I'm going to put that F to the top to find what my basic chord is. Fifths don't need to be included. My structure tones are the root, third, and the seventh. 1, 2, 3, 4. I have a major third, so that's G major. G to F is a seventh, so that's actually a dominant seventh chord we'll talk about in some later videos. So this is a G7 over F for the lead sheet symbol. For my Roman numeral analysis, this is the 5 chord because C to G, that's the fifth scale degree for your G7. 4-2 is actually the third inversion of this triad, which we'll talk about in a later video. But it's the dominant chord back home to the tonic. So once you've gotten your chord analysis, that serves like a roadmap so you see. This is where I really need to think for my chord changes. The next reduction technique would be like we did with the Moonlight Sonata and just isolate the chord changes, which makes it feel very simple. So I go back to the beginning of the left hand, play your one chord. Chord changes would be 4-6-4. 5-4-2, back home to the one chord. That makes it feel really simple in our left hand. So practice it that way till left hand is comfortable. Then you can use your reduction technique to play it hands together. So we're gonna block the left hand every 3 beats, going to play the right hand above it. This will let you pay attention to the intervals of the right hand. 4, 5, 6, 2, up a sixth, back down to that landmark G, up a sixth, same two notes, now we're in eighth notes, seconds, 4, 6, 4, changed, look ahead on long notes, down to A, down a fourth, up a fourth again, same thing, look ahead, uses the fourth and eighth notes, down by steps, back home to one. So where you probably felt a little crunched on your timing is where those chord changes happen, so certainly just go back and isolate those, like measure 7. Take it hand separate and push it, and that will help it become more automatic. Okay, let's finish up with our musical learning pyramid. Now that we've figured out notes with that really helpful reduction practice, and you can use this reduction practice on patterns such as waltzes you see in music, Alberti bass, anything that's chordal, but it's fleshed out into an accompaniment pattern, reduce it down to its basic chord. That way you can process more information at one time, let you look ahead and play more musically. Finishing up, we have articulations. I see two slurs, so I'll play smooth. As the performer, you could decide if you'd like to play the other notes more detached. Romantic air, you could all play it romantic, so up to you. I'm going to voice my right hand melody. I'm going to shape it according to the rise and fall of the music. So I'll play it now normal in terms of no blocking and in a sweet style. 4, 5, 6. So try out this reduction practice on your own and other pieces that have accompaniment patterns, playing from your chord charts will actually make this reduction practice even more useful, because you'll be seeing one chord name and you'll have to know what three notes go down with that. Happy practicing!